Welcome back to the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm your host, Rob Dew. I'd like to thank Paul Joseph Watson for covering the news portion and Alex Jones for also sending in that report on Kelly Thomas. Right next to me now, I have Patrick Henningsen, who's a writer and contributor to InfoWars.com, and we are about to release a special report that he produced. It's called Open Borders, Special Report on Fast and Furious. And with that, Patrick, how you doing?
I'm good, Rob. Thank you very much.
So tell us about this report. Who did you interview? What kind of information did you uncover? You were letting me in on some stuff behind the scenes, but it sounds very interesting.
Yeah, originally I entered this through the Sheriff Joe Arpaio's investigation of Obama's documents, birth documents, and Social Security number. And when we did that report with Rob Jacobson, when Rob came down, I met a number of people in the connected with the government here. And I was originally looking at doing a story on SB 1070, which is the federal lawsuit that DOJ has slapped on the state of Arizona for enforcing its own immigration laws. And through this story that I did on SB 1070, I learned that there are quite a few people in the government here that have intimate knowledge of Operation Fast and Furious. And so that kind of grew out of that. And I met a congressman who is Carl Seals, very helpful and very generous with his time. And also he then referred me on to the ranking senator in the state legislature and another senator as well. And they kind of told me the inside scoop on Fast and Furious. And I've recorded some interviews with them. And also I spoke to owner of a gun shop. It's at the center of the Fast and Furious investigation. I'm not going to say his name, but anybody following the story probably knows who I'm talking about. But he wasn't able to speak because he's currently on federal subpoena. Apparently, there are big things afoot in the next few weeks or the next month with regards to Fast and Furious. And that was told to me by the owner of that gun shop. And also, we've also got, you know, the situation of Fast and Furious, it's affected Arizona directly, not just crime in the Phoenix area and along the border, but it's also affected, people have lost their lives basically here. And that's the main thing I wanted to get across in this film. I haven't found a comprehensive report on Fast and Furious when I was doing my research. So I decided that I'm going to make a comprehensive report on the origins of Fast and Furious and also what is the agenda behind it. And it's not just a theory. There's this theory that by some people that the government is incompetent, that the federal government is just incompetent. That is a...
The memos. We've seen the memos. CBS reported on them that they were looking for stories to go against the Second Amendment to create that demonization process. Now, let me ask you this. Did you cover the fact that Bush was doing this before and that this goes all the way back to even the Reagan administration when they were shipping guns for drugs and doing all this with Iran-Contra? Did you start there or did you just start with Fast and Furious?
I started with Operation Wide Receiver, okay, which was hatched in 2007 under Roberto Gonzalez, and that was gun walking. I didn't go back further than that because I wanted to keep this to a short length of a film. I have enough material to do a 45-minute or a one-hour documentary, and I think I'll probably work on that in the next few weeks. But Operation Wide Receiver was different than Fast and Furious because Operation Wide Receiver required federal agents to keep an eye on the guns as they tracked them over the border into Mexico, and also required the feds to coordinate with the Mexican authorities and at least to try to apprehend or to break gang activity and cartel crime. Operation Fast and Furious has got none of that, and I kind of really illustrate that clearly in my film. And also I've got highlights of all the really good congressional testimonies that I was able to get from C-SPAN, who gave me permission to use those as well. And also we've got the senators in this state, you know, this isn't your normal breed of politician. And this is the thing that really surprised me is I don't want to use the cliche, but these are real patriots working down here whose chief concern is their constituents and their citizens and guarding the liberties of the residents of Arizona, and they came out on camera and said and spelled it exactly what it is.
Right.
No mincing words, that this is a conspiracy by the federal government to gin up opposition, in the words of Senator Gould, to demonize the Second Amendment and to restrict gun ownership in the second term of Obama.
Sure.
So this isn't something we're talking about, Rob. This is something that the highest ranking members of the state government in Arizona are saying publicly.
Well, are they planning on pressing any charges or filing anything in court to against, you know, Eric Holder and the Department of Justice? Is that even possible? Can we file charges against the Department of Justice for doing this?
Well, Daryl Issa has brought everyone knows by now, Daryl Issa has brought a contempt charge against Eric Holder. I mean, he's been proven to be lying. I've got his testimonies against backed up against the CBS reports to show that he is a liar.
Right.
And also, I also said revealed also that the White House intimidated CBS into dropping Fast and Furious coverage last year.
Mm-hmm.
So they're involved in bullying with the media to try to kill investigation into what is a completely failed operation that is actually illegal. On its face, it's illegal.
I would like to see the state of Arizona file charges against Eric Holder personally and drag his butt down there for questioning and grill him, because that's what they need to do, because they're not doing that job in Congress. Issa is doing a whitewash, honestly, because he knows that they did it under Bush. And he's just kind of playing the field, oh, we're going to keep this a left and right paradigm thing, when they're both sides are doing it. And that's what really pisses me off.
Well, the thing is, they did it under Bush, but they at least had some accountability in that operation. This one here has no other function other than to demonize gun owners and also to restrict the purchase of firearms in the border states, particularly Arizona and Texas. And both those states have very liberal gun laws. And, you know, as Senator Gould said, we can't forget that, you know, as Americans, we have the right, if we own property, we have the right to sell property to each other. And that includes gun shows. So they're trying to use Fast and Furious to create, and this is also something else, Rob. I had a senator lecturing on camera what Hegelian dialectic is.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And how it applies to Fast and Furious. And I couldn't believe I was hearing this. And I thought, wow, you know, I don't often feel really proud of the public servants. But when I heard Senator Gould talking about this, I felt proud that we had people in the state legislature who think like this and who are have this level of political awareness,
right,
and aren't going to be hoodwinked by what is clearly a federal government out of control. And I said this at the end of the film. I said, this is a federal government that's out of control. And at some point, the child thinks it's become the parent. And that's what's really that's the big theme here is the state's sovereignty. And the original contract with the Constitution, the 50 states, gave limited powers to the federal government. And now we have a federal government that's now become a national government. And this is the main point of the film that I hope people get. And this is what was said by the senators. We've gone from a federal government to a national government. And can you believe what the implications of that? And the reality of that is the baby steps towards a complete totalitarian socialist state.
Well, if you look around you, that's what most of the slobs want. They want to be taken care of. They want government to take care of them and provide for them from cradle to grave. And it's unfortunate that we're seeing that more and more, and that we actually have to speak up to get the rights that were granted to us under the Constitution and under God. You know, frankly, let's go to the gun owner. You talked to the gun owner. You didn't talk to him on camera, but you relayed, parts of what you had in your conversation. What was he telling you?
Well, he couldn't speak to me very much because he's under FBI surveillance. And this is what the Department of Justice does. They're using the FBI politically to spy on witnesses on a big up. What is going to be a big case, which is in the works right now regarding indictments. And there might be indictments. He didn't say specifically, but he said, I'm not going to say anything, but just there's going to be big, big developments in this month of May with regards to Fast and Furious. But You know, he was nearly put out of business by the ATF's little operation. And, you know, it's honest, hardworking Americans just trying to run a business. And here they've got the federal government involved on a deep level in basically trying to entrap and also do the worst thing possible, which is arm criminal cartels over the border.
Mm-hmm.
With guns. And, you know, and also the other thing my film spells out clearly, and I took clips from the White House SPP meeting with Calderon and Obama in May, which is that they're trying to make this fallacy that it's American guns that are, you know, getting into the hands of the Mexican cartels. And it's a total lie. I've outlined it from A to Z in the film. So I wanted to make a film that if someone didn't know about Fast and Furious, they can watch this and get up to speed and see what the real issues are. And I think I've achieved that with this 20-minute film. But the other thing, Rob, I'm going to say is I've never edited a film before. So this is my first one. I taught myself with free software. I used a handheld HD camera. I had a very inexpensive lapel microphone, wireless system, and I did this on free software. And the reason I did it is because I want to also demonstrate to people out there in the info war that you don't need to spend a lot of money, you don't need to have heavy equipment or even the best software. Now, if I redo this film, I might do it on Premiere or Final Cut Pro. But this version, I wanted to show what you can do. So there's no barrier to getting into the info war. You can make a really good film that's better than anything Michael Moore makes.
how dare you get off your butt and do something productive? Yeah. How dare you?
And so this is an example. This film, this is my first go at a film. And I think it came out pretty well. And also, it's just to show that you can do this with little or no resources. Money should not come into the issue in the info war. So look at this film, anybody watching it, and say, right, I'm going to go out and I'm going to do something similar. The doors were open for me. They invited me into the state government, Rob, to talk about
They're looking for people to talk to about this. Yeah, you know, they're dying to talk about it. I got two final questions here. Did the gun owner know he was part of Fast and Furious when it was taking place?
He's the gun shop owner, Rob.
The gun shop owner. Yeah. Was he aware that he was part of this operation?
He was. He was basically he had illegal straw man purchasers come into the shop buying loads of semi-automatics and so forth. And it red flagged immediately. Some of them had criminal records.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay, and he calls up the FBI or the ATF and they say, No, sell him the guns.
What?
Yes, and I've got all this on camera, okay?
Yeah.
This has been recounted by the senators.
Yeah.
Scenario. It wasn't from the gun shop owner, but
right.
This is to show people the level of crime that we're looking at with Fast and Furious. This scandal threatens the Obama administration more than any other scandals, and Lord knows he's got his share.
Okay? Oh, yeah.
But this one doesn't involve bribery or Watergate lying or corruption. No. This involves lives. The men have died in the line of duty, and these are good men. They have families, and this is a direct result of Fast and Furious. And that's another big hammer I hit home at the end of the film. This isn't about Watergate tapes or lying or bribery or corruption. No. This is about lives.
Right. No, and two lives in particular, Judge Roll and Congresswoman Giffords.
Well,
did you go into that as talk to them about that being a possible assassination attempt because they were investigating Fast and Furious together?
I spoke about that to one member of the government, and he didn't have much forthcoming information on it. So I kind of realized that trail is not going to go anywhere right now. But I'm going to revisit that trail later, Rob. I've also got invitation by the DPS to go down in an armed escort along the border and film if I want to take this to another level. So that's a little caveat. But, you know, the Gabriella Giffords, Judge Rolls thing definitely is going to be looked into. But also we've got Rob Krentz, rancher who was shot and killed on the border.
Right.
This is linked with Fast and Furious. And Pinal County Sheriff's Deputy Louis Perrault, who was wounded by AK-47 fire. Three AK-47 gunmen triangulate and fire on a sheriff's deputy. He was rescued within an inch of his life. Okay, this is some serious stuff going on down there. And it's in the people in Washington, personally, I don't think they're serious. They don't really care. They just care about their political agenda, which is to demonize gun owners, to demonize private property, and to demonize the Second Amendment. That's their chief concern. They don't care about their lives.
And collect payoffs from the special interests. Don't forget that. Patrick, thanks for doing this film. We're going to premiere right now. We appreciate your hard work. And I guess you're heading off to England, so we'll see you next time. It'll be over the pond.
Yep, definitely.
All right.
Thanks, Rob.
And with that, we're going to have the premiere of, it is called Open Borders Special Report, Fast and Furious. This is a good primer to send to your friends, spread it around, watch it, take notes, do your own research. Wayne Madsen was the one who uncovered this judge role, Gabby Giffords link. And I really think this could, my gut tells me that's part of the triangle of what we have going on here with government buying guns, shipping them down to Mexico, and then blaming it on the Second Amendment. And with that, we're going to go to the film. And that's all for our show today after that. And I'm Rob Dew, and this is InfoWars Nightly News. And thank you for watching. If you're watching this on YouTube, please consider becoming a member. It's very easy to do. You go to prisonplanet.tv. We have a 15-day free trial. It's very easy to do. Help us out. Help us spread the word. If you can't get a membership, maybe get your friend to get a membership. And, you know, you can share your passcode with up to 6 people. There you go. That's all we have for today. We're going to go to the movie now. Open Borders Special Report, Fast and Furious. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you next time.
We have two Border Patrol agents who are dead, who were killed by guns that were allowed, as far as we can tell, to deliberately walk out of gun shops under the program often called Fast and Furious.
Did you ever approve or sanction investigations that allowed gun walking?
No, not to my knowledge.
Now that you've been briefed on it, the president has said on March 22nd that you didn't authorize it. Did your Deputy Attorney General James Cole authorize it?
I'm sorry, did the
Deputy Attorney General James Cole?
Did he? I didn't hear, did he?
We have a dead Border Patrol agent in Agent Terry. We have 2,000 missing guns. We have 200 deaths in Mexico. We had dead government officials in Mexico. We have a Mexican helicopter with troops in it that shot, three of which are wounded, back in May of this year. We have 50-plus members of Congress calling for your resignation over this, and you've never spoken to any one of these people about this operation.
I think it's very important to recognize that you, as the Attorney General, with all due respect, need to be held accountable, or someone does, as to what happened.
I should be held accountable for certainly my role in whatever I did or didn't do in connection with the supervision of Fast and Furious. But, yeah, I'm Attorney General of the United States, and I should also be held accountable and perhaps even given some credit.
This program, as you know, and the president's been asked about it, you've been asked about it, allowed for weapons to be sold to straw purchasers, and ultimately, many of those weapons are today in the hands of drug cartels and other criminals. When did you first know about the program, officially, I believe, called Fast and Furious? To the best of your knowledge, what date?
I'm not sure the exact date, but I probably heard about Fast and Furious for the first time over the last few weeks.
This was the lie that made U.S. Attorney General Eric Holder the focus of Fast and Furious investigations. Documents obtained by CBS News prove that Holder lied, but their veteran reporter, Cheryl Atkinson, soon became a target of the White House, who attempted to intimidate the network into dropping their coverage of Fast and Furious, believing it should remain above the law, even in the face of damning evidence of their illegal operation, an operation conveniently hidden inside President Obama's 2009 stimulus bill, and an operation that flooded the Mexican black market with thousands of illegally obtained firearms. The first incarnation of federal gun walking was hatched in 2007 under the watch of then Attorney General Roberto Gonzalez through Operation Wide Receiver. But that operation required federal agents to track firearms into Mexico and worked with Mexican security services to trace guns and apprehend cartel criminals. Unlike Fast and Furious, which had no tracking, no tracing, and no real objectives, in what can only be described as a federal government appearing to partner with organized crime in Mexico. As a result, the violence has increased on both sides of the border since Fast and Furious went live in 2009. In April 2010, Pinal County Sheriff's Deputy Louis Perrault was shot and wounded by AK-47 fire, but was rescued, narrowly escaping with his life, in an incident that prompted one of the largest manhunts in state history involving some 200 officers from multiple agencies. Rob Krentz, scion of one of the Southwest's most well-known ranching families, was shot and killed on March 27, 2010, most likely by traffickers who were using his land to mule narcotics over the Mexican border and into the country, as is captured by these hidden cameras along some of Arizona's most well-known smuggling routes. ICE Special Agent Jamie Zapata, assigned to human smuggling and trafficking, was gunned down in cold blood in February 2011, whilst in the line of duty and traveling in Mexico. And DHS Border Agent Brian Terry, a member of the BORTAC unit, was shot and killed on December 14th, 2010, northwest of Nogales. And the gun recovered at the scene was traced directly back to Operation Fast and Furious. InfoWars traveled to Arizona, to the state capitol, to speak to senators and congressmen about the details of Fast and Furious, and also to discover the real agenda lurking behind the operation.
The Fast and Furious incident with this whole thing, what brought that to light was one of the weapons used to kill Agent Terry was one of the guns that was sold as part of the gun walking program that the U.S. Attorney General and the ATF were involved with, where they were selling guns to people that were known criminals who failed an FBI background check, where the flag, the gun dealer, the gun owner said, hey, this guy comes up bad, and the FBI said, sell it to him anyways, sell him the gun anyways, even though they knew that this was a bad sale.
They had people that violated the law, that they essentially bought weapons that were in an illegal straw man transfer, and then lost track of those, if they ever had the ability to even track them at all, as they were sold into a crime syndicate.
In the previous stings that were done by the federal government, the agents were required to maintain eyes on the firearms and not let the guns out of their sight. In this particular episode, they were buying lots of guns and just flooding the illegal market with these guns and not actually tracking the guns. So a lot of these guns crossed into Mexico, and the agents, no one knew where they were. And in this particular episode, those bandits that encountered Agent Terry were carrying some of those firearms that were bought and transferred to them during the Fast and Furious operation. We talk about the gun owner or the gun store owner here in Arizona that had raised the red flag and actually tape recorded a conversation with the FBI and ATF over the phone where he had said, hey, look, I don't think I should sell this firearm. And they're telling him, you need to sell the firearm. And he said, no, I don't think I should sell it. And they said, well, we're telling you to sell the gun. Well, the guy sells the gun, and then a couple weeks later they come in and raid his store and get all his records and try to make it look like he was the bad guy, and they were going to try to pin it on him that he had sold these illegal guns to these illegal, what we call prohibited possessors. And during that effort, he was able to bring up this phone call and provide, and then of course they backed off. But the ATF went in there and raided his store to try to make it look like he had been illegally selling firearms, when in fact he had covered himself, luckily, with a tape-recorded telephone call to cover his rear end. And it's fortunate for him. Had he not done that, the ATF would have gone after him, shut his business down, and probably thrown him in jail. So this is part of the effort, and I think it's wrong. You know, you take a guy trying to do an honest day's work, and then you keep enticing him, until eventually the guy, you know, reaches a point where he gets sucked in.
Here in the United States, we've increased cooperation on our southern border and dedicated new resources to reducing the southbound flow of money and guns.
Clearly, I expressed it to President Obama and to Prime Minister Harper that the fight that Mexico is experiencing for a safer North America also requires a strengthening of national actions, amongst other things, to stop the traffic of weapons.
The Obama administration was trying to create a situation where they could put more repressive gun control on the United States and by perpetrating the fallacy that Mexican drug cartels are using American-made weapons in their war with the Mexican government and with each other on the border.
And we sustain that the expiry of the assault weapons ban in the year 2004 coincided almost exactly with the beginning of the beginning of the harshest period of violence we've ever seen.
That's a fallacy in itself. These are automatic weapons. They're not buying them at gun shows in Arizona, and they're not buying them at gun shops in Arizona. Those weapons are semi-automatic rifles. They're using full automatic weapons that were originally manufactured as automatic weapons. These are not conversion weapons. These are originally manufactured as automatic selective fire weapons. So it's not some garage conversion. They're buying these things on the foreign market. They're not coming out of the United States. And you even saw Mayor Bloomberg of New York after the Gabby Gifford shooting, which he does any time that there is a shooting, is he goes to states where we allow people to sell guns back and forth to each other at gun shows and tries to gin up opposition to you and I selling Grandpa's deer rifle at a gun show, because we need to remember that guns are property, you know, and that as free Americans, we're allowed to sell property to other people. And all this really does is deprive the law-abiding citizen of the ability to own a gun. And I think that's their end goal, to tell you the truth.
Only a small fraction of the firearms in Mexico are coming from the United States. Most of the large caliber automatic weapons are coming from Central America and other parts of South America and the Southern Hemisphere. There are some guns coming from the United States. We're a border with Mexico, so yeah, people, and we've caught people trying to smuggle guns out of Arizona, and they've been caught trying to smuggle them into Mexico. So there is some gun trafficking going on. But to blame Mexico's problems on the United States is just par for the course for President Calderon and anybody else. Everybody blames the United States, and they won't blame themselves. We have a failed narco state to our south, where the cartels have corrupted the Mexican government, and there is no desire on Mexico's part to deal with this problem the way it should be dealt with. And because of that, you know, their scapegoat excuse is to blame the United States. And I think it's just, again, trying to shift blame on the United States. We're not the problem in Mexico. Mexico is the problem in Mexico.
The federal government's been at war with Arizona over illegal immigration for nearly a decade. Even more so under the Obama administration. Essentially what they've done is they've created a situation where we have Mexican crime spilling into Arizona. We've had drug cartel crime. We've had execution style crime happen in the Phoenix area. And a lot of this is, one, the federal government will not defend the border. And even worse than that, now they're even arming our enemies essentially on the Mexican side of the border. You know, it's essentially treasonous because these are being used against American citizens. They've traced these even to execution-style murders of Mexican attorneys recently as this week. You know, so they're creating an unstable situation on the border. You know, it's bad enough they won't defend us against illegal immigration, but now they're essentially arming the people that profit from the drug trade on the border.
They still haven't properly funded border resources. They talk about it, but in all reality, they're not serious about it. I mean, we know Fast and Furious is clear evidence of that, that they're not serious. They're not. After the Krentz murder and the Officer Brian, and as an outgrowth of Fast and Furious, they're not serious. I dare say it's going to take. I think it would take probably an armed invasion of, say, Nogales or Douglas for them to probably send out the National Guard.
It's a failure. All of these incidents come from one source only, and that is the failure of the federal government to gain operational control and protect the sovereignty of this country by securing our border. I mean, that's really the problem. Agent Terry would be alive today. Rob Krentz would be alive today if the federal government had done its job and secured this border to make sure only lawful commerce comes across our borders. And, you know, we love trading with our trading partner, Mexico. You know, I got the Port of Douglas. I got the Port of Nogales. You know, we want trade to occur, but we want lawful and legal trade. And the federal government has failed to encourage lawful and legal trade and, ironically, has actually encouraged illegal trade through Fast and Furious because they are subsidizing illegal gun running in the state of Arizona. So instead of securing the border and promoting legal trade, they're actually leaving the border unsecure and sort of supporting illegal trade, which is just an astonishing thing, and it's backwards.
Did the Deputy Attorney General authorize it?
My guess would be no. Mr. Cole, I don't think was in the I don't think he was in the department at the time that operation started.
But he's been aware of it much longer.
Been aware of it much longer?
Than you have, since you've only been aware of it a few weeks.
You have to understand the way in which the department operates. Although there are operations, this one has gotten a great deal of publicity.
Yeah, they're dead Americans.